My head. blessings. There will be blessings on blessings. Oh, hey, I see blessings, blessings. Lift up your name, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for such a time as this, God, and we give you the glory and the honor and the praise for being God in our lives, Father God. And even now, Lord God, as I stand before you, Father God, I decrease, Lord God, that you would increase, Lord God, that you, Lord God, would speak and that you, Lord God, would do what you want to do, Lord God, as long as you need to, Father. I submit to your will and to your way, and I ask the Spirit of the living God now to speak. Be glorified, be magnified, and be lifted up, God. And in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen and amen. Amen, amen. Amen. Good morning to Cup of Salvation and to all of those who might be downloading the broadcast on YouTube. I just thank God for being here. I want to say to Cup of Salvation, I love you and I certainly miss you and can't wait to see you sometime in the future. Amen. Praise the Lord. I want to dive right into the word of the Lord today, though. Still talking about kingdom. Last week we talked about those five characteristics of keys to the kingdom. And I want to continue to talk about the kingdom perspective because that is the only perspective that matters. This kingdom of God is just as real as the earth that we live in, but we have to be able to see it through the eyes of the Spirit. And I conclude, man, that this Bible is about the King and about the kingdom, and to a lesser degree, about the royal citizens of the kingdom, the King being Jesus Christ our Lord, and the kingdom being the kingdom of heaven, and those royal citizens to a lesser degree being you and I, and those of us that have received Jesus Christ as Lord. For the Bible tells us that ye are a chosen generation, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who've called you out of darkness and into this marvelous light. So I want to have a little bit more discussion about the kingdom and looking at some other characteristics of this kingdom lifestyle. Go with me to Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. And it reads as thus, and seeing the multitude, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. And if I might leave you with a subject this morning, I just want to ask you a question. Are we still blessed? Are we still blessed? The meaning of this word blessed being joyful, being favored, being lucky, being privileged, being select, being glad. The one I like, though, is being happy. Being happy. Are we still blessed? You see, the first pre-message selection of the year at Cup of Salvation was done by Worship and Warfare, and the song was called Blessing on Blessing. And after looking at what has transpired since then, over the past 5 or 6 months, some in the body of Christ might wonder if it's still the case. Are we still, in fact, blessed? You see, we are in the midst of a once-in-a-century virus that has killed 170,000 people with no end in sight. We're seeing large numbers of unemployed and underemployed, not seen since the Great Recession of the 1930s. We're seeing evictions on the rise since the mortgage and rent moratorium ended on July 31st, along with that extra $600 a week that millions of people were depending on to pay their rent. We've seen rioting and protest in our streets due to racial injustice and police brutality. We're seeing alcohol sales, gun sales, and domestic abuse up some 25%. Not to mention a government that's not giving the country much support, but doing all it can to hold on to power by any means necessary. And with all that said, can we really say in America that we're still blessed? That every time I turn around, blessing on blessing. You see, if I had to answer from the world's perspective, I might say, no, we got some work to do. We got a mess in this country. However, because I'm a kingdom citizen, I believe that I can say without a doubt that we are still blessed, and in fact, that there is blessing on blessing. For the psalmist says in Psalms 144 and 15, it says, happy is that people that is in such a case. Yea, happy is that people whose God is the Lord. Thus, to live in a state of blessing, the criteria is that Christ must be our Lord, because our happiness is not dictated or predicated by the external. It's dictated and predicated by the internal. You see, it's not dictated by the car I have or the house I live in or the size of my bank account or the job that I have, not diminishing any of those things. We need those things. Those things are important in our lives. They are resources, but not our source. So it's not to diminish any of that. In fact, I want all of that. I want all that God would have for me, because the blessings of the Lord make it rich and he addeth no sorrow with it. So I'm not diminishing the external at all, but it's the internal that defines whether or not we are blessed. Now, don't get me wrong. Our external can definitely mess with our internal. If our external is not right, it can mess with our head. It can mess with our mind. It can mess with our joy. It can have us operating in a spirit of doubt or fear temporarily, if you will. There's no doubt that it can certainly mess with us if the money ain't right. It can certainly mess with us if we don't have a job. It can certainly mess with us if our housing situation is not right. I'm not diminishing any of that at all. But this blessing, this kingdom blessing from the Lord, comes by way of what's on the inside of us. Because the Bible tells us that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. That's what defines our blessedness. That's what defines our happiness. It's that greater than that lives in us, because he's greater than any job that we will ever have, or the lack thereof. He's greater than any car that we could ever drive. He's greater than any house that we could ever live in. He's greater than any bank account, no matter how small or how large. He's greater than. In other words, whatever you can think of that's going on in your life, that has gone on, that is going on, and that will go on, Christ is greater than. But let us review the text again. Matthew 5, starting at verse 1, looking verse 1 through 3. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. And this kingdom is real, man. The Bible speaks of kingdoms from the Old Testament to the New Testament, from Genesis, man, to Revelations. The Bible is speaking of kingdoms. We see kingdoms rise and fall, but there's only one kingdom that will stand and endure the test of time, and in fact, will endure forever, and that is the kingdom of God. We sing a song here. We hadn't sung it in a while, called Ancient of Days, where it says, blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation bows before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne in worship. You will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away. O Ancient of Days. And so we trust in the Ancient of Days. We trust in the Lord thy God. In fact, the Bible tells us to trust in the Lord with all of our heart and lean not to our own understanding, but in all of our ways, acknowledging him, and he shall direct our path. And we most certainly must do that in these times if we're going to operate from that kingdom perspective of blessedness. And so the third verse says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. What is that all about? You see, that poor in spirit are those that know they need God, are those that know that they have tried this thing on their own and they're not finding much success. Those who know that they've tried to operate in their own power and in their own strength, and they've made a mess of their lives, and they know that they need God desperately. Those who have come to realize, I've tried to do it every way that I could, and I find that it's vanity and vexation of spirit without the power of God. In fact, David said, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways and sinners shall be offered unto thee. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God of my righteousness and my tongue. Hallelujah. You see, I need you to understand that David knew that without a shadow of a doubt, he needed God. He knew even before the Holy Spirit was loosed on the day of Pentecost, he knew that there was something different about him when the Spirit of God would rest upon him. And so he knew that without this Spirit of God resting upon him, he was nothing. And so we must understand that when we start to talk about being poor in spirit, we're not necessarily talking about the physical as much as we are the spiritual. We're talking about the spiritual to the degree where we come to understand that we need God and God alone. But he goes on to say, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. See, our blessedness, this is not necessarily about of the physical dead, if you will. It's our mourning should be more about the spiritually dead. It should be more about those who have had the opportunity to receive Jesus Christ as Lord, but continue to reject him. We should mourn for those who have had that opportunity, but continue to turn their back on him. Because the priority of the Father is that all men would be saved. Thus, our hearts should be in mourning due to the wickedness of man in the earth. But even in that mourning, God has said, we are blessed because we will be confident. And my heart goes out to those that I have sown the word, that I have continued to call on, that I have continued to press to make Jesus Christ their Lord, and they continue to turn and walk away. My heart is grieved. My heart mourns. But the Bible says that blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. I'm going to be comforted in the midst of all of it. Because the truth of the matter is, saints, is that you'll hear more no's in your lifetime than you will hear yeses. You will experience very often more rejection when it comes to the things of God than you will folks receiving it. And so it brings about a mourning in your heart because you really want people to feel what you feel. You really want people to experience this God, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the way you do. And so there's no doubt that your heart begins to cry out. Your heart begins to mourn. But God said, you know what? Blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted. He says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. You see, the meek or the humble are those that are gentle in spirit, but also disciplined. Those who have submitted themselves to the will of God and who see themselves from God's viewpoint, because that's the only viewpoint that matters. You see, I've heard it said, don't take my meekness for a weakness, because very often we perceive meekness as a weakness. However, meekness is actually strength under the control of God. As I was looking up meekness and digging in, one of the Greek words for meekness or meek is praus, P-R-A-U-S. And it actually speaks to the demeanor of a horse that has been broken for riding. You see, wild or untamed horses are very hard to ride due to their strength and power. However, after it is broken, it still has that same strength and power, but that strength is now under control of its owner. Thus is strength with a purpose. You see, when we were sinners, we were untamed. We were wild. Now that we are under the influence of the Holy Spirit, whatever strength we had is under control of God. It is now strength and power with a purpose. It is now strength and power under the hand of God. It is now strength and power with a mission. Thus, these meek are those that will inherit the earth. The next one says, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. You see, those who thirst and hunger after righteousness kind of remind me of King David, when he said, oh God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee, my flesh longeth for thee in a dry and a thirsty land where no water is. You see, David was one who hungered and thirsted after the righteousness of God to the degree that he became a man after God's own heart. Thus, when you are hungry and you thirst after righteousness, everything you do is with an intent to please God. When you really hunger and thirst after righteousness, everything you do, everything you say is with an intent to please God. That becomes your mission in life. However, the challenge is to remain hungry. The challenge is to remain thirsty for righteousness and not compromise your standard for men or for an audience. And that's what so many get caught up. They compromise the righteousness of God to get a crowd in the room. They compromise the righteousness of God to get people in the building. They compromise the righteousness of God to get a certain number of likes on social media. But we cannot compromise the righteousness of God. We must speak the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And honestly, we're in a climate where people don't want to hear the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. They don't want to hear about judgment. They don't want to hear about sin. They don't want to hear about hell. They just want to be encouraged. But if I encourage you on this side and you die and go to hell, what good have I done for you? So we must be those that hunger and thirst for righteousness, because the longer you stay in this thing, the harder it is to continue to thirst and hunger for righteousness. We find it hard to have that hunger and thirst for righteousness like we did when we first got saved and we just couldn't get enough. And so it's not so much the new ones in Christ that I'm actually worried about, because the new babes in Christ are the seekers. They're excited about the things of God. It's those that have been around this thing for a while and believe it, they know some things, who find it hard to hunger and thirst. And the hunger and thirst must be such that we continue to tell the truth of God, whether we're received or not. You see, those that hunger and thirst after righteousness will be unwavering, because the path to heaven, listen, is straight and narrow. And the Bible tells us that it's few there be that find it. Listen, everybody that's talking about heaven ain't going. Because we know that the road to destruction is what? Broad and wide. And so in this hour, we must continue to preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. We must have a hunger and a thirst for the righteousness of God to the degree that we have a right standing with God, a right standing with men, and that we live our lives to the degree that it aligns itself with the word of God. Because if it aligns itself with the word of God, then we see that we're operating in this place called righteousness. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. These are kingdom characteristics. Merciful being those who have compassion for others, because the Lord showed that same mercy to us on the cross when he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In fact, the Bible says that Jesus was moved with compassion to heal and to deliver. You see, unless you have real compassion for folk, you're going to find it hard to bring healing and deliverance. Unless you have real compassion for folk, you're going to find it hard to love them to the degree where you can bring healing and deliverance. And so true compassion causes us to move on somebody else's behalf. True compassion causes us to step out and meet a need. True compassion for folk causes us not to be able to stand back and say, man, I sure feel sorry for them, but to step in and actually help bring a solution to the problem in their lives. And Jesus was so compassionate that he moved to bring about a change in folks' lives. And in this hour, we have to be so compassionate with folk that it moves us to help bring about a change in folks' lives. That's really what it means, man, to serve the Lord. That's really what it means to be called to serve. That when we see a need, if we can bring change, we're not sitting back waiting on somebody else to do it, because God might have raised you up just for this purpose. God might have raised you up just for the purpose of meeting a need in somebody's life, and then you miss your purpose. And the saddest part of life is living a life having not fulfilled my purpose. Doing something, for sure, but having not fulfilled what God has for me. Listen to what Matthew 14 and 14 says. It says, and Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion toward them, and he healed their sick. Matthew 18 and 27, then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him and forgave him of his debt. How do you know you have real compassion? Not that you're feeling sorry, but that you're willing to come forth and help bring about a change in somebody's life. To come forth and to meet a need, if possible. Verse 8 says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Pure in heart being those that are becoming more and more like Jesus every day. They aren't sinless, but they're sinning less and less. They're not perfect, but they're striving for perfection in Christ Jesus. They are truly allowing the sanctification process to work in them and through them to shape and make and mold their lives into what God would have it to be. In fact, they have that, what you call that, that St. John's chapter 3, verse 30 thought process, that he must increase that I might decrease. You know, that's one of my favorite prayers. Lord, let me decrease that you would increase. Lord, let them see more of thee and less of me, because if they see more of thee and less of me, then I know that I have the opportunity to operate with purity of heart. It's a simple prayer. Don't make it about me, Lord. Make it about thee. Because if we make it about him, people's lives will be changed. People will be healed. People will be delivered. People will be set free. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Peacemakers. Those who look to do good and find good in all men. Those who look to build a bridge between men of conflict. Those who look to de-escalate a volatile situation. And in fact, I believe it was Romans that says, as much as lieth within you, live peaceably with all men. You see, you get to control how you're going to react to a situation. Nobody else gets to dictate that. Satan doesn't even get to dictate that when the Spirit of God lives on the inside of you. Satan rolled up on Jesus, I believe it was in Matthew chapter 4, dealing with the temptation, and threw everything at Jesus that he had. And Jesus replied, man, it is written. It is written. It is written. You see, because when trouble comes, what's on the inside is going to show up on the outside. Pressure is going to push out what's on the inside for everybody to see. And so as much as lieth within you, you live peaceably with all men. You allow the Spirit of God to control you and not the situation around you. I said it before. Let the calm in you control the chaos around you, because at times there will be chaos around you. And it only takes one bad moment for somebody to see you in a very different light. And so the peacemakers are those who look to de-escalate a situation. Those who do that will look more and more like their daddy in heaven. Remember, the Bible says, for they shall be called the children of God. And I don't know about you, but I want to operate in the spirit of a peacemaker so I can look like daddy. so that I can resemble Daddy, so that I can resemble my Father which is in heaven, because I chose peace. And in fact, the Bible tells us to follow peace and holiness with all men, without which no man shall see God. Verse 10 says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Persecuted for righteousness' sake. Not many of us are persecuted for righteousness' sake, but for those that are, when you're reviled, when you're lied on, when you're talked about, when you take that stand for Christ, when people drag your name and your reputation through the mud. It could be done by friends. It could be done by family, but especially your enemy, because of your stand for Christ, when people ostracize you for righteousness' sake. Jesus said, you're blessed. Jesus said, you're blessed. You see, because if you're really teaching and preaching the truth of the gospel, you won't be accepted everywhere. You will not be accepted in all circles. And you have to decide whether being blessed by God is enough for you or whether or not you just want to be accepted with that group. You got to decide what's more important. For me, I choose Jesus. I hope that's your choice as well, to choose Jesus. Whether you're lied on, whether you're talked about, whether you're persecuted and reviled, whether you're ostracized from certain groups and from certain people, listen, rejoice and be exceedingly glad. You see, blessedness from the kingdom perspective is the state of the inner condition of the believer. These beatitudes don't teach a man how to be saved. It describes the kingdom characteristics of those that are saved. And you see, Jesus is not as concerned about our external as he is our internal. But now that doesn't mean that he's not interested in our external, because we know that he is. We know that he's interested in all of us. For the Bible tells us in 3 John 1 and 2, beloved, I wish above all things that thou would prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. Let's look at that again. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou would prosper and be in health. In health. That's physical health. In health. That's economic health. In health. That's mental health. In health. You see, we don't just tie that to physical health. He wants the total man to be in health, in emotional health. But then he goes on to say that thou wilt prosper and be in health. Listen, even as thy soul prospers. And so he's interested in your natural, but he's more interested in your spiritual, in your spirit man. Because we can have all the things that the world could ever offer and still miss heaven. We could have all the things that the world could ever offer. In fact, we know that King Solomon had everything that the world could offer. And he declared that it was all vanity and vexation of spirit. He said, fear God. He said, let's hear the conclusion of the whole matter. And that's to fear God. keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. And so no doubt, he's interested in all of you. And I'm not diminishing the external because we need it. In fact, we should have it to be able to demonstrate much of what God is doing for us. But he said in the midst of that persecution, in the midst of being reviled, in the midst of having your name dragged through the mud, maybe even by those that are closest to you, verse 12, he said, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. And understand, in this Christian walk, man, it ain't easy. Nobody is getting out of here without some trouble. Nobody is getting out of here or getting to heaven without some trials and tribulations. The Bible tells us that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth them out of them all. Thank you, Lord, I'm blessed. He said, I've spoken unto you that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulations, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. In other words, be happy. Be happy. Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof. Clap along if you feel like happiness is the truth. Clap along if you know what happiness is to you. Happiness is to me the feeling of the Lord Jesus Christ on the inside of me. Because if I have him and I obey him, I have the opportunity to see every promise in the word of the Lord fulfilled in my life. But I must be willing to operate in those keys that we talked about last week just a bit. Faith and obedience. So if you're going through, continue to go through. If you're being talked about, lied on, name being scandalized, if it ain't no truth to it, the Bible says, let us rejoice and be exceeding glad. For great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. If they persecuted the prophets, it's possible that they will persecute you, whoever they is. If they persecuted your Lord and Savior, it's possible that you could be persecuted or you could go through something as well. And when that time comes, no need to complain about it. Let us rejoice and be exceeding glad because we're doing something right. In fact, we're doing something righteous. Kingdom happiness is built from the inside out, not the outside in. Let us build on the only wise God, our Savior, to whom be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. At the end of the day, the only happiness that will last on this side is the happiness and the blessedness that we find in Christ Jesus. Because all other is temporary. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you and we give you the glory and the honor and the praise for your presence. We thank you, Lord God, for being in our midst. We thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity to talk a bit about kingdom, Lord God, and just how real this is, Lord God, to us as citizens, Lord God, of the kingdom. Father, I heard one say in a song some time ago that it's all about the kingdom. And Lord, there ain't no doubt that even the more, it's all about you and the kingdom. And so, Father, we bless your name and we magnify your name this day, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for Jesus speaking, Lord God, to us about these beatitudes and about the kingdom characteristics of those that are saved. And to know, Lord God, that we're not controlled by external stimuli, but we're controlled by the Spirit of God that lives on the inside of us. And in fact, we are blessed by that. Father, we give you all of the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praise, Lord God, for the word. We give you the glory and the honor and the praise, Lord God, for all of those out there, Lord God, who know, Lord God, that they are blessed, and in fact, that there is still blessing on blessing. And for those of us, oh God, that are, let us, Lord God, be a blessing to others. Let us, Lord God, demonstrate the power of compassion to the degree that we're willing to bring about a change in those that are less fortunate. Father, we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise for the word. And we magnify you, Lord, and we glorify your name. It is in the mighty and the matchless name of Jesus that we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Thank you for visiting us at Cup of Salvation Online. As you listened, we pray that God was able to reach you, teach you, and set you free. We invite you to subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear more of God's word. And if you'd like to sow into the work we're doing at Cup of Salvation, please go to cupofsalvation.org/give. God bless you, and we'll see you next time.